Because this dam that is being built in Ethiopia is a very large dam and is nearly complete, and now they start filling the dam. And the filling process implies that there will be less water flowing to downstream Sudan and Egypt, and that has raised a lot of concerns, especially with Egypt. No, it is not. It was already the Emperor Haile Selassie who in the 60s invited American experts to come up with some ideas, and then they developed an idea to construct a cascade of reservoirs, of four reservoirs, on the Blue Nile to generate a lot of electricity. And it was a dream of Haile Selassie to make Ethiopia great again. But that never materialized because of all kinds of problems, internal problems in Ethiopia. However, the idea resurfaced in the context of the Nile Basin Initiative. Now, the Nile Basin Initiative was a large program led by the World Bank and supported by many donor countries to help the Nile Basin countries to come to a formal water agreement. And that's difficult because it implies 10 countries, and now 11 with South Sudan also joining. It was a complex program. And this Nile Basin Initiative had two tracks. One was indeed to get the political track, to get the agreement done. And the other track was the development track. And the idea was to invest in projects, water-related projects, from which the Nile Basin countries would directly benefit. So this idea came actually from David Gray, now professor in Oxford, but at that time an expert at the World Bank, who proposed that it is better to talk about benefit sharing than water sharing. Because benefit sharing means that we allocate the benefits from water projects over the various countries involved. So with this in mind, the Nile Basin Initiative had a program of joint multipurpose projects, JMPs. And one of the joint multipurpose projects was to develop a cascade of reservoirs on the Blue Nile, the old idea of Haile Selassie, but then by the three countries together, by Sudan, Egypt and Ethiopia. And the idea was that the dams inside Ethiopia on the Blue Nile would generate electricity that would be also used by Sudan and Egypt. So the old idea came to the surface, and for 10 years the countries worked very hard to make this a reality. And the idea was to first start with a smaller dam, a bit upstream, and then earn money and build the next one, and then build the next one. And then you are of course very efficient, because then the same drop of water is used four times before it flows into the other countries. So this was an interesting initiative. There were all kinds of impact assessments done, social impact assessment, ecological impact assessment, and all were rather positive. So everybody seemed to be very happy, and of course the World Bank would help finance all this, until in Egypt a new water minister came to power. It must have been in the end of 2009, that at the final moment when all the lights were green, he said, no, we don't accept it. And that, of course, was a huge disappointment for the Ethiopians and for the charismatic prime minister at the time in Ethiopia. And he was so disappointed that he said, okay, then we do it alone and we will build a big one. And that's what he did. And this dam is the Renaissance Dam. And they started construction, I think, in 2011. And it's not yet finalized, but now is the time to start filling it. So that's the background. Now, that was a big problem, because the idea of the original plan was that all the countries riparian to the Nile would agree, and then the World Bank could have given a loan to Ethiopia. But now, with Egypt not agreeing, there was no international bank willing to provide a loan to Ethiopia. So Ethiopia had to do it alone. And so the government instituted a whole program to entice Ethiopians to contribute the little money they had, their own little money they had, to help invest in this huge project. Many Ethiopians, also in the diaspora, assisted and were very proud to contribute, and of course others were not so proud to contribute because they had so little. So there was also a bit of sometimes force, that people were forced to contribute. But many Ethiopians that I know have happily contributed money to building this huge dam. Yes, Egypt is unhappy, and that has a bit of a history. Egypt is very much dependent on the Nile waters for everything, for its development, but also for its food and and it has been for 6,000 plus years. I remember that perhaps the first hydrologist was an Egyptian, and the first staff gauge, or the first gauging station in a river was built on the Nile. The Nile is therefore very important for Egypt, and any attempt to interfere with the flow is watched with a lot of suspicion. Now, it's very interesting to realize that, for instance, the first big construction on the Nile outside Egypt was the Owen Falls in Uganda on Lake Victoria. That's the outlet of Lake Victoria, where it becomes the White Nile. That was constructed, I think, in the 1950s, when Uganda was still a British colony, and the Britons negotiated with Egypt to get permission to build the Owen Falls hydropower plant. So, from that day, there is an Egyptian official in Jinja, in Uganda, sitting there to watch and check whether sufficient water is released through Owen Falls into the White Nile, eventually to benefit Egypt. Now, exactly the same happened with the Rosiris Dam built in Ethiopia. And again, there Egyptians check whether sufficient water is being released down the Blue Nile that eventually will flow into Egypt. The Gerd Dam, the Grand Renaissance Dam in Ethiopia, is the first time that there is a unilateral action on the Nile that is not based on an agreement with Egypt. And that is for Egypt unacceptable. They would like to have an agreement before another country starts interfering with the flow of the Nile. And given the history, you can imagine that fear is real for the Egyptians. And the filling now of this GERD, the Renaissance Dam, is being done unilaterally without an agreement about how this dam should be filled. All the experts say that this is the right time to start filling the dam. Why? Because at this moment, Lake Victoria is high. There's a high water level. The High Aswan Dam has also a high water level. So there is no drought. And the rain seemed to be, this year, starting in July, seemed to be very, very positive. So there's a large discharge in the Blue Nile. And what I just have understood is that in the last week, about 5 billion cubic meters of water has been filled in the new dam. That's very little because the dam is very big. It is 70 billion cubic meters. But this is exactly as per the agreement, preliminary agreements reached in the negotiations between Sudan, Egypt and Ethiopia. And you must realize that in the negotiation, there's two tracks. There's the political track, the ministers of foreign affairs, but there's also the water ministers and the water experts. And the water experts of both Ethiopia, Sudan and Egypt have their models and know exactly what is going on. And they have already in detail reached nearly an agreement about how the filling procedure will be. And the first stage would be simply to get to the first stage, which is the first 5 billion cubic meters. And that was basically reached last week within a week's time because of the high flow. So by default, the negotiations are now opening again because there's now a fait accompli, which nobody has nearly felt because of the high flow, and there was no impact to Egypt. Yeah, so far the Ethiopians have used very little water from the Nile, also because they have a better climate, more rainfall than of course in Egypt. But there's one thing that we should realize. Ethiopians have consume relatively little electricity. To give you an idea, the average Ethiopian consumes five times less than the average Sub-Saharan Africa consumption of electricity. And the Egyptians consume per capita 17 times more on average than the average Ethiopian. So you can imagine that there is merit in the government of Ethiopia trying to produce more energy for its population. To give you an idea, the generating capacity of the GERD is equal to 1.5 times the current electricity consumption in Ethiopia. So the GERD is in that sense very important for Ethiopia. Yeah, so it is actually very interesting to realize that under the Nile Basin Initiative, this donor-funded program to stimulate and promote the collaboration between the Nile countries, the atmosphere was not very good and very antagonistic. At one moment, Egypt walked out of the negotiations on the agreement on the full Nile. Then Ethiopia started to build the GERD dam. And since then, Sudan, Ethiopia, and Egypt have had very intense negotiations and talks. There's never been a moment in history where these three countries have had such intense negotiations and contact. So in a way, this has promoted mutual understanding, despite all the political rhetorics that currently exists. So I think that I'm pretty optimistic that there will not be a war on the Nile, but there will be more collaboration, because at this very moment, Egypt is perhaps more electricity short than water short, and I guess that soon Ethiopia will export electricity, surplus electricity, first to Sudan and then also to Egypt. And then the original plan starts to emerge. So I'm a bit optimistic.